gather together in His name to worship Him and to praise Him. Want to encourage you. Just get everything off your mind right now with the Lord Jesus Christ. And let Him touch you. Let Him bless you. Let Him speak to your heart. Let Him speak to your need. Let Him speak to whatever that you may have right now. And He has come, we have come into this house to praise Him. And with as we praise Him, the Bible teaches us that we build a place that He inhabits. We build the atmosphere for Him to dwell in our midst. Yes. And the Bible also tells us that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Yes. And I don't know about you, but I want liberty this morning. Yes. I want freedom this morning. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord forevermore. So glad to have each and every one of you with us this morning. We have some that are out sick. I just got a text from Brother Wayne a minute ago, and he says he has a terrible cough that he's afraid to be around people, so that's why he stayed home this morning. Sister Mary Vi is really sick right now with a terrible cough, and she needs our prayers while she's not here. Some are on spring break, and we miss them. There'll be others that'll be continuing to come in this morning. But we are glad you're here. We're glad for those of you that will be with us to be a virtual church. And we know that this service is going to be a blessing to you as well. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning as we begin our service. And we want to remember those on our prayer list. We have many that are on our prayer list. But you know, I've got reports and don't have time to share them all right now. But the Lord is moving. The Lord is blessing. And the Lord is doing a great work. And I attribute this to the prayers of praying people. Because when God's people pray, things happen. Praise the Lord. Our great God of heaven, we come to you this morning. And we're so thankful, not only for what you do for us, we're so thankful for who you are. That you are the great I Am. That you are the creator and the sustainer of this universe. And in all that you are as God, that you are mindful of us. That your ears are open to our prayers and your eyes are upon us. And your hands are continually outstretched to lift us up and to minister to whatever needs that we might have. And Lord, we are so thankful and we are so grateful today for all that you do. We pray today, Lord of heaven, for these on our prayer list. That my Lord, you would minister to every need and every situation. Lord of heaven, for those that are here today, every home that's represented, every family that's represented, every need that's in this place this morning. My Lord, we decree and we declare by faith right now in Jesus' name that the needs be met. Praise the Lord forevermore. Hallelujah. Let's continue to worship.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is all we need. Hallelujah. It's not money. It's not a job. Although those things are necessary, we do need them. But it's our God who provides. Yes, He does. He is Jehovah Jireh, God our provider. Let's sing Jesus this morning. There is a truth older than the ages. Kingdom. God longs for his creation to worship him like the angels in heaven. He has cherubims that fly, and all they do is sing, "Holy, holy, 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 holy to the Lord," with such awe and reverence. And I wonder, does he long for his creation to praise him in that way? He said if we won't praise him, that he'll call for the rocks to cry out.
Yes, amen.
I would hate to have a rock with my name on it.
Yes, amen.
That cries out in my place. I want to worship with God that all that I am.
Yes, that's right.
With all my being, with all my heart and all my
yes.
soul. How about you this morning?
Who but God could create such a beautiful world in which we live?
Jesus.
With all the things that we enjoy, Some things we might not enjoy, but they serve a purpose. And who but God could formulate it all to come together the way it does? Who but God can know how many grains of sand there are on the seashore? How many drops of water are in the ocean? And a God so great, and a God so mighty, and a God so wise, so powerful, you are always on His mind.
That's right, amen. Yes.
You're always there. His ear is always listening for your voice. His eyes are continually upon you to help guide and direct your path. His hands are continually outstretched. So much so that His Word says He will give His angels charge over us, that they will bear us up, least at any time we dash our foot against the stone.
Yes.
That's how mindful He is of us. Oh, He's a wonderful God, isn't He?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. And we love Him this morning, and we praise Him, and we worship Him from the bottom of our heart. Brother Glenn is going to come this morning and going to bring the word today. And I know the Lord has laid something upon his heart, burst something in his spirit. I can feel it. We're going to be blessed, and the Lord's going to touch. And just open your hearts, open your minds. Get it. Forget about everything else. We've all have things we have to do when we leave, but that's after a while. And if we focus on the Lord right now, we'll leave this place rejoicing, because we have been in the presence of the Lord.
Yes.
And He has touched us in a special way and met some very special needs. Well, man, come on.
Amen.
And get ready to worship the Lord this morning as He ministers.
Leave right now.
Take your liberty, Lord. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Thank you.
Glad you're in church this morning. Am I just on?
No, it's
nope.
Not yet. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, then it will be on this morning.
It'll be on in a minute, okay. How many of us will be preaching this morning? Came anyway.
Glory to it. Yes, amen.
Go with me to the book of Exodus, chapter 9 first. No, chapter 14 first. Exodus chapter 14. Everybody there?
Getting there.
Okay.
Not there, say, well, I'll wait on you. Is everybody with us now? Exodus chapter 14, verse 26. And the Lord said unto Moses, stretch out thine hand over the sea, that the waters may come upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and upon their horsemen. And Moses stretched forth his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to his strength when the morning appeared. And the Egyptians fled against it, and the Lord overthrew the Egyptians in the midst of the sea. And the waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen, and all the host of Pharaoh that came into the sea after them. There remained not so much as one of them alive. But the children of Israel walked upon the dry land in the midst of the sea, and the waters were a wall unto them on their right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day out of the hand of the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead upon the seashore. And Israel saw that great work which the Lord did upon the Egyptians. And the people feared the Lord and believed the Lord and His servant Moses. Now go back to your left to chapter 9. This is a verse that I'm going to bring up. It's going to be actually our main topic in verse 16 of chapter 9. And in very deed for this cause have I raised thee up. Now he's talking about Pharaoh. This is Pharaoh he's talking about. In Exodus 9, verse 16. In this very cause I have raised thee up, for to show thee my power, and that my name may be declared throughout all the earth. For this very deed. Let's pray. Lord God, I do thank you for church this morning. I thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit. Thank you for the wonderful songs that mean so much and lead us into a more ready state to receive what you have for us. And I'm praying, Lord, that you'd anoint this word. I ask that you would guide and direct it. Please, Lord, touch me, touch everyone here. May we all be under the anointing of the Holy Spirit this morning. We give you praise and glory and acknowledge we can do nothing without you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, a little while earlier, the children of Israel, they were fearing for their lives. They were desperate. They were, there was nowhere to go. They had, in front of them was the Red Sea, and behind them was one of the most mighty armies on the planet.
Yes.
And so, but now, the verse we read, they stood on the other side of the Red Sea, and they had nothing at all to fear. In a short amount of time, it all changed. Without so much as a slingshot, their pursuers, an entire army, was crushed to death by the same water that led them across safely. And now the Red Sea was nothing more than a vast graveyard of men and horses. For Pharaoh, it was an irresponsible, mindless loss of life.
Yes.
Their leader had set them at war with God himself.
Yes.
And he knew that. He knew God was involved in this. He knew that God had done all the things before, but he sent them anyway. He sent them into a battle that there was no possibility for victory. It couldn't even be said that they died for the glory of Egypt, because they died to the shame of Egypt.
Yes.
They died to the glory of the God that Pharaoh despised. He called them, their God, a God of slaves. Now, that's something to think about there.
Yes.
He said we can't acknowledge your God as God. He's just a God of slaves. We can't have any respect for your God. He's just a God of slaves.
Right.
And so he despised their God. He hated their God for even saying that he was a God, because how could he be a God of slaves? Well, it's ironic that the only cause that they died for that day was to glorify God in the eyes of their enemy.
Yes.
Pharaoh had blindly sacrificed an entire army, his firstborn son, the lives of thousands of his countrymen, the health and welfare of the entire country, all for the glory of the God that he hated.
Yes.
The God of slaves.
Yes.
And you have to ask yourself, how could a man born into royalty, a man of culture, a man of higher education, a man in such a high position, do something so blindly stupid? That's the only way I know to put it.
That's it.
You know, they're stupidly blind and they're blindly stupid. This
yes.
is both.
Yes.
This is both of them combined here. And you'll notice in verse 16, it's a strange text. It said, I raised for this very deed, I have raised thee up. Well, it is a monument to God's power then, right? The Bible tells us, I believe it's in the book of Hebrews, beware of the goodness and the severity of God. As good as God is, he's just that severe.
Yes, he is.
As good and as wonderful as God can be, he can be just that severe and just that yes. terrifying.
Yes.
True.
Well, Pharaoh proved God's power to help, protect, save, and deliver. He proved that God is a God that is unmatched by anything else or anybody else.
Yes.
As far as taking care and saving his people, no matter if it takes dividing the Red Sea, having the walls of water stand at attention, the ground dry up, then walk all the way across to the other side, and then when the army comes, he closes the whole river on top of them. They never even had to have a slingshot to protect themselves. God took care of the whole
thing.
Yes, he did.
Yes, he did.
The only thing he said do, Moses, rose, stretch your rod out over the sea so I can do this thing. That's interesting enough, but that's another lesson.
Yes.
Well, Pharaoh also proved God's power to disappoint, to wreck, and completely destroy. And in Pharaoh's destruction, God tells us that he has achieved his purpose. Now, that's a strange picture.
Yes.
He was born for such a thing.
Yes.
How are we supposed to deal with that? That's a strange thing. This is the very deed that I have raised you up.
Yes.
So how are we to look at this? That a man is born for the purpose of being destroyed, that's his very purpose. From the time he was in his mother's womb, he was meant to grow up and be destroyed, to be God's enemy. Could it mean that God's plan is that some would go wrong and that others would go right? That it's God's purpose that one should develop into a Moses and the other right at his side should grow up and be a miserable wreck, a murderer, a killer designed to be destroyed by God for the glory of God? That one is as much a part as the other. If that's true, then it will take away my free will.
Yes, it will.
It will take away my right to choose whom I would serve. It would take away my hope. And that's the reason I always had a problem with predestination. Because we serve a God of hope.
Yes.
If I'm predestined to be this or that or something else, then it takes away my hope.
Yes.
If I'm born to be destroyed by God, if I'm born to be God's enemy, if I'm born to just live and go to hell, that takes away my hope. So that can't be right.
That's right.
Well, how are we supposed to deal with it? Well, God never planned that any man should go wrong.
That's right.
He's not willing that any should perish. God loved Moses, but this is the point. He loved Pharaoh just as much.
Yes, he did.
Whatever failure we make of our lives is not because God forces us to.
That's right. Amen.
There's been many times in several times in my ministry that someone has told me that God's out to get me. You know what I said? If God was out to get you, you'd be God.
You'd be God. That's right.
That's all it is, too. If God's out to get you, you've got no hope, brother.
That's right.
You might as well hang it up.
Yes. Amen.
Sit down, lay down right there and die. Go out to the graveyard, lay across something. If God's out to get you, you're going to be God. Best you can do is cry for mercy. But God loved them both.
Yes, he did.
Whatever failure that we make of our lives, we do it on our own. There's never God's plan that one should fail.
That's right.
And if we do fail and make a wreck of our lives, it is because of our own willful rebellion against God.
Yes.
And you can blame it on nothing else. You can say, well, the way I was raised was bad. And that may be a bad thing, but there have been people that's come out of that that's done wonderful things for
yes,
God.
Yes, there are. That's right.
The truth is, God's plan is that we all succeed. But he cannot force us to enter into his plan. It's his plan that we all succeed. But he can't force us to follow his plan.
Amen.
You know, parents, we realize that, don't we? With our children, we have plans for our children. We have high ideals.
Yes. Amen.
You know, sometimes, I'm not going to say that, it's on TV. But as parents, we understand. You can't make somebody do what you'd like for them to do. Even if it's right, even if it's wonderful, even if you've got it all laid out, you understand how it's all going to work. It doesn't matter. You can't force someone to follow that plan because children, they have their own will.
Yes.
They have a will to do just exactly what they want, and they express that too.
Yes.
I want to bring it up. Jeremiah chapter 18, I'm going to bring this in so I want you to understand how I'm coming and what I'm coming at. You don't have to go there. It's where God told Jeremiah to go down to the potter's house and watch.
Yes.
And so he goes down to the potter's house and he looks in, and what he sees is three things. He sees the potter, the wheel, and the clay. And then he sees the potter standing at the wheel working with the clay. And the potter had already seen, before he ever began, he already seen a finished work in his hand. He already knew what he was going to accomplish here.
Yes.
But the Bible says that he found a flaw in the clay.
Yes.
So he had to stop what he was doing. He had to work it out, take out that part that was not malleable or whatever happened to the clay and set it to the side, and then he had to change his mind on what he was going to make. And so he worked again and he found something else that wasn't quite right, and he had to take that piece out and set it to the side and then begin to make something else. But this is what God was trying to get Jeremiah to see. That if we reject God's best, you see, God already has a plan. From the time that you're in your mother's womb, He already has a plan for what He wants you to do.
Amen.
But He can't make you follow that plan. When you go so far, and God realizes that He's going to have to change His plan now. You've gone too far this direction, and it's going to be too hard to bring you back. He has to change His plan, right? And so he takes out this part that's not usable. He sets it to the side. He sets his sights. He has another plan now. It's not his best plan. It's not his first plan, but his second plan. And if you still won't follow that plan, it falls into another plan. But this is the problem. It gets to where you can't work with the clay anymore. It becomes, you keep adding water to it. Something in the molecular part of it, I'm saying that right, the molecular part of it is changing. And it becomes hard even though you're working with it. You can't shape it because it's just not enough there. It's been there too long, been trying too hard, and it's just not malleable anymore. So you ever heard of potter's field? That's what that is. That's what potter's field means. It means that there was a piece of, there was a work that they never could get it to what they wanted it to be. It never could set up anything that was useful. And so they would take and toss it out in potter's field and it would break. And just lay out there.
Yes.
What could have been, what should have been.
Yes.
A long time ago, I think I was still a youth pastor when I preached a message called Hold Out. And God revealed this to me. I was looking at an automobile that had just been a complete crashed up mess. And you know, the thing that we hear the insurance company say, okay, it's going to take more to fix this car than what it's worth. Now see, that's what I feared all my life. That I was going to be to the place that God would say, there's going to take more to fix you than there's time.
Yes.
I'm going to have to set you to the side and bring somebody new up.
Yes.
To begin to train them to do what I intended for you to do.
Yes.
Yes.
That would be a great disappointment, wouldn't it?
Yes, it would.
Well, that's the story of Potiphar. God had a noble purpose for his life. God gave him every opportunity. Pharaoh could have done great things for God, could he not? In his position, with his power, he could have done great things, but he rejected all of it. He denied God. He rejected, resisted, rebelled until ugliness just found a home in his heart and just lived there. Until he closed every door open to him. He turned a deaf ear to God until he became deaf. He closed his eyes to all that was good until he was blind to anything good and could only see and sense and feel what was bad. Behold the goodness and severity of God. Pharaoh chose the opposite. That's the difference between the lives of Moses and Pharaoh.
Yes.
Not that God proposed good for one and evil for the other one. They made the choice, just like we made the choice. I promise you, I wonder how many people went to bed last night planning on getting up and going to church this morning.
That's right.
But they didn't make it. Too cold, maybe. Listen, I can't get this picture out of my mind. The folks in Ukraine, the lives that they're living. And sometimes I feel guilty sitting out on my porch, in the porch swing, reading a book. Supper's getting ready. Everything in my life is good. And I feel guilty because these people, I can't imagine what it would be like to live with bombs going off in the distance.
That's right.
So what are we to do with that? Did you know that there are 100,000 Christians that are martyred every year for their faith? Did you know that? 100,000 Christians are killed every year because they believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
Yes.
And we can't get out on a cool morning to go to church. These things bother me.
Yes, amen.
Well, as far as Pharaoh and Moses, two children grow up in the same household. One goes terribly wrong, the other goes honorably right. I know, as I was putting this together, I thought of several that I know of. Side by side, same home, same this, same that. Sometimes grew up in the same bedroom. You know. One went terribly wrong, the other went honorably right.
Yes, amen.
What seems to be a growing problem in America today is, and I've known this to happen several, just in my small circle of friends, that one of them just decides that they don't want to be married anymore. They don't want to be a Christian anymore. And some of them have said that they don't even believe there's God anymore. They were raised in church.
Yes.
They were married to Christians. The ones I'm thinking about are married to preachers. I'm sick of being a preacher's wife. I'm sick of going to church. I'm sick of Christians. I'm sick of serving God. I found somebody else. See you later.
Yes.
You know, it's easy to find an exit in this time of the great falling away. This time of the great deception.
Yes.
Has there ever been a greater time of deception in the history of this planet?
No.
My question is, what are they exiting to? You know, whenever all these people had come to listen to Jesus preach, and there were a thousand there, maybe thousands, and he said, "You have to drink my blood and eat my flesh." And they all said, "This is just too much to get. We're leaving." And he walked over to the disciples and said, "Are you not leaving?" And they said, "It's probably one of the most honorable the most sensible thing they said their whole time with Jesus. They said, where are we going to go? Where are we going to go? Right. We ain't got nowhere to go. We're with you, man, through thick and thin. Here we are. We ain't going nowhere. And that's kind of the way it has to be, isn't it?
That's right.
It doesn't matter what happens to me in church. It doesn't matter who does what or who says what or how things work out. Where am I going to go if I quit? Where am I going? What's my plan?
Yes.
Well, any road that leads away from God is a trap.
That's right. Amen.
It is.
So the great warning of our story is that it is possible to play too long. A great point to be made here is when Jesus stood, you remember where he stood looking over into Jerusalem, and he was crying and he said, I would have brought you under my wings like a mother does her for the little chickens, but you would not, and it's too late.
That's right.
That's the first time I realized that there are doors that close.
Yes.
It's too late now. Everything that God has sent you, you've either destroyed it, destroyed their reputations, destroyed them, killed them. You done everything that God done, you done away with them. Everything that God sent you, everything he tried to teach you, you turned your back on it, you quit, you walked away, you left, and now it's too late.
Right.
But what breaks your heart, he said, I would have brought you in.
Amen.
I would have put you under, I would have protected you like a mother. Have you ever seen that? I've seen that once in my life. At my grandparents' house, they had, this is when I was a kid, and I didn't know, I thought chickens come from the store. But he goes, I watched him, he said, we're having chicken today, okay. Well, let's go get one. If I go out, I'm expecting to go downtown. He walks out to the pen and reaches down and grabs it, all right, just, like that chicken slopping all over the place. But he had chickens. I guess I should have brought that up. But he had chickens, and there was a storm moving in, and she had little chicks, and he said, boom. And she did like this, and they all ran under. She just sat down like this.
Yes.
Jesus said, that's what I would do for you.
That's right.
But now it's too late. Well, God has a plan for every life.
Yes.
And it's time to take advantage of God's grace,
yes,
his mercy, and his kindness.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Take a stand and take our place to do the work for God that he's called us to do.
Yes, amen.
We'll ask our pastor to come. I want you to bow your head for just a moment this morning. There's so many things that God can work with. Even in this small congregation, things that the Holy Spirit's been dealing with you about in your life. We know that our time here is short. We see it. Not only do we see it, we feel it.
Yes.
If it's time for you to make your stand for God, I want you to come up here to Ricky and I.
Yes, hallelujah.
I want you to come up here and stand and just receive what the Lord would have for you to do. Lord God, I hold these people up to you. I pray for the direction of your Holy Spirit. I ask you, Lord, that you would speak to us as only you can. Holy Spirit, we allow you to do your work and your service. Help us to take our eyes off ourselves. Help us to look at things the way we should be looking at them. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, speak to you. I want you to come. I want you to come and let Ricky pray with you. Accept what God has for you.
maybe in a moment of hurt, maybe in a moment of anger. And we've looked back and regretted that decision, regretted that choice. But we get to a place where we say, well, I've come too far. And I've done too much. And the Lord won't forgive me anymore. But you listen to this preacher this morning. As I tell you, that is one of the biggest lies that the devil has ever tried to tell you. Today, my biological father was killed in a wreck in Oklahoma, driving a truck. Long story short, there, and I'm not going to take the time to go into it, but I become angry. I become bitter because I had prayed and prayed and prayed and prayed for his salvation, to see him saved. And I felt betrayed by God. I felt that God had forsaken me and forgotten me and turned his back on me. How could he take someone that I loved so greatly away from me without answering my prayer to save his soul? March 19th was a Sunday morning just like today. That Wednesday, after the funeral service conducted at Hale South Funeral Home on Cherry Street, walked out of the chapel, got in a car to go to Kingsland to the cemetery where we would bury him. Full of hate, rage, anger, hurt. Probably any emotion and every emotion you can think of. In that car, I made a choice. I don't want anything to do with God. If he'll take my dad without saving him, I don't want anything to do with him. And I turned my back on ministry. See, because I was an evangelist at the time. I was holding revivals. Turned my back on it all. For the next several years, lived in rebellion, hard, full of hate. Thank God there were people that were praying. There were people that were calling my name out in prayer. Thank God the Lord never gave up on me. Kind of like that piece of clay that Brother Glenn was talking about, that he just kept trying, wanting to mold and wanting to do something. And his voice kept drawing me. Come home. Come back. Lord, I've done too much. Lord, I've made too many mistakes. Lord, I've done this and this and this, and because of that, I'll never be able to be effective as a preacher again. And because of this and this, Lord, I don't know if you can forgive me or not. Until one night, many years later, around, I think, 1997, 1998, June of that year, I went to a camp meeting service in Forest City, Arkansas. needed to make a change. I was tired of the way things were going. I was tired of my life the way it was. And I had a moment in this service like we're having right now, where the invitation was given. And I walked up to the front. That line of people were standing. They had a group of preachers there to pray for folks to come up. And I can remember it like it was yesterday. The words, "Lord, I'm sorry. I've made some terrible mistakes and I've been wrong and I regret it. You know all the negative and you know all the wrong and you know all the things I've done. But Lord, if you can find it in your will to forgive me, I'm not worthy to be what you call me to be as a young man. But Lord, if you just save my soul, I'll do what I can do to work on the sidelines for you." I hope I haven't gone too far, Lord. I hope I haven't been too bad, Lord. Please forgive me. And I want to tell you, the wave of the presence of the Lord came upon me, and I knew from that moment I was forgiven. I knew at that moment I was forgiven. The Lord began to rebuild it. He began a restoration. He began to do a work in my life that I thought would be impossible. But see, he didn't worry about the mistakes. He didn't worry about the things of the past, because all that was under the blood. He began to take the present right then and right now and begin to mold and shape into what he wanted me to be. I stand before you today as a result of that. Not perfect by any means, but I have been forgiven. You don't know me what I was then. Not a person under the sound of my voice knows me what I was then. And I thank the Lord for that. But I said all that to say this powerful word that Brother Glenn has brought us this morning. I felt the presence of the Lord in this place this morning. The Holy Spirit said that the enemy has been trying to whisper in some ears, "Well, you've gone too far. You've done too much. You make too many mistakes. God doesn't want you. It's a lie from the pits of hell. I don't care what you've done, where you've been. Whatever's in your past can be just that, in your past. Because if you'll come stand with me right now, we're going to pray together. And as far as the east is from the west, any transgression will be removed. And as it's removed, it will never be brought up again by God. He loves you. His Spirit is tugging at your heart right now. He's whispering in your ear right now. So whatever it is that's holding you back, whatever it is that you've been struggling with, if you let that seed of faith that's inside of you right now take hold, the Lord wants to move in your life for such a time as this. Will you come? Will you come? Holy Spirit of God, I thank you that you never give up on us, that you're always there to draw us in, to try to woo us back to you. I pray for everyone under the sound of my voice, those that are in this sanctuary this morning, and those that will be around the world that will be watching this via virtual church. We open our hearts to you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Praise the Lord. So glad that each and every one of you are with us this morning. I want to remind you, Wednesday night, we are continuing in our Bible study, People of the Spirit. And we are just that. We are God's, we are a peculiar people, a chosen generation, that we are to show forth the praises of Him into this world in which we're living. We are people of the Spirit. So you want to be here for this. We're having some real good discussions and things in our Bible study on Wednesday night. Let's remember one another. There's several that are out this morning. We'll remember them in prayer. Remember our prayer list. Pray for one another. You can always pray for me. I promise you, I need it. Let's stand and be dismissed with a word of prayer.